Today's debate. This is the Meyer Horowitz Forum, arguably the most important forum of this election. All races for the 2013-2014 executive and board of governors representative will have an opportunity to make their case for you, as well as we have a representative from the UPass Yes referendum side. Thank you for coming today, and to those who are following us on the live stream at su.ualberta.ca/video. The format of the forum will be each candidate will get 2 minutes speaking term, followed by an opportunity to ask their opponents a question for 30 seconds, followed by a response from the other candidates that is 1 minute long, followed by a rebuttal that is 1 minute long. After all the races go, then we'll have an opportunity to ask questions from the mics. If you are going to ask a question to the president or the vice president student life race, please use this side of the stage or this mic. If you're going to ask a question for any of the other races, please use this stage. When you are asking a question, please direct a question to the race, not to a specific person in the race. Otherwise, I'm just going to rephrase your question or not allow it. And lastly, we will be accepting questions from Twitter. If you ask your question to a specific race at hashtag UASUVote. All right, we will start right now with the first race, which will be the Board of Governors representative. Mr. Brent Kelly has 2 minutes to speak.
Testing, can you hear me? Excellent. Ready?
Oh, I'm counting.
Okay. All right. Hi, everybody. My name is Brent Kelly, and I'm running for re-election for the position of Undergraduate Board of Governors Representative. Now, there's 3 main initiatives that I want to bring forward over the next year that will serve to benefit the undergraduate student body as a whole. The first of these initiatives is to continue developing and strengthening the coalition of associations on the Board of Governors of this university. Now, the purpose of this coalition is to provide better opposition to university administration-led initiatives that aren't in the interest of undergraduate students, such as tuition increases, fee increases, or cuts to faculty and staff. So I want to continue building and developing upon this coalition. The second initiative I want to bring forward over the next year is to amplify advocacy on the Board of Governors by better integrating the undergraduate Board of Governors representative position within the already existing advocacy frameworks of the Students' Union. The Students' Union president has access to a lot of great advocacy resources through the Students' Union that I don't feel the Board of Governors representative position has equitable access to. So I want to ensure that advocacy efforts are maximized on the board by ensuring equitable level of access to these advocacy resources. The third initiative I want to bring forward over the next year is to institute a system of mandatory tabling for elected student representatives to close some of the distance between the average student and their representative. The unfortunate reality is that students don't know a lot about their students' union. Nevertheless, never mind how to get involved in their students' union. So this tabling initiative will be an opportunity for the average student to get in touch with their representative on a day-to-day basis or a week-to-week basis. I will draw upon best practices from students' associations across the country as I implement this program to ensure that it's an effective and efficient program. That's just a little bit about my platform. For more information, you can check out my website at brentkelly.me or send me a tweet at bkelly on Twitter. Anyways, that's it.
Thank you. All right. Well, the next race we have will be the race for the Vice President Student Life. The first candidate is Kevin Smith, who is representative by Mr. Dylan Hanwell. You have 2 minutes.
All right, so first of all, as you can see, I'm not Kevin Smith. I'm Dylan Hanwell. I think I'm a little better looking, whatever. But first of all, I want to tell you why I'm here, because I think that's pretty important. I'll be frank with you. Kevin Smith, I think, first of all, is a personal friend. But second of all, I think he's the best candidate for this job. I think that he has the best platform, he has the most experience, and he has the most solid ideas that are going to be constructive in the student life portfolio. For these reasons, I took the time out of my schedule to become familiar with his platform points and to come up here in front of all you guys and talk about why I think he's the best. So I'm going to talk a little bit about his platform. He has three platform points, just like everybody else. Increased awareness, strength in services, and continuous support and development. So when we talk about increased awareness, I think one of his biggest and most constructive points is the street team. So you see the Students' Union with all these different events that they have. He thinks that they're great events. He thinks that they're really good for the culture and the community that surrounds the University of Alberta and the students within it, but it's not promoted to the extent that it could be and not kind of persistently shown to students as a way that they can become involved in their community. Secondly, strengthening services. He actually brought out a strategic plan that he wants to put in place to help student services. And thirdly, because I know I'm running out of time, continuous support and development. Now, this is actually what I really think is a good idea. When you think about the ways that you got involved on campus and the ways that you were engaged, it was through already created student groups and through people that helped you through that. So Kevin Smith wants to actually give more power and more,
or not,
sorry, more power, empower these student groups so that you create a more engaged campus through those student groups. For these reasons, we hope that you vote Kevin Smith.
Thank you. All right, next up is Mr. William Lau. You have 2 minutes.
Thank you. We're running out of time, guys. My name is William Lau, and I'm one of two candidates running to be your VP Student Life. And I want to tell you a little bit about my vision. And the vision is why I'm running for VP Student Life. I know I have a vision. It sounds a little bit cheesy, but here it goes. And when I close my eyes and I think about what a healthy U of A could look like, I see students smiling, I hear them laughing, I hear conversation, I hear music. I see more color during the day and more lights at night. And that's why I'm running to be your VP Student Life. Our environment directly influences how we feel, not only our physical environment, but the groups that we interact with and the conversations that we have. But let's get to something more tangible, shall we? What can I do for you? Am I even in a position to say what's best for you? And no, I'm not. And that's why the first thing I want to do as VP Student Life is to create these communications between the student body and the Students' Union. I think that the best way to facilitate this conversation would be through social media. Lately, U of A Confessions has flooded my Facebook wall, and I've seen lots of conversations that students have had with students, and it's actually pretty meaningful stuff. Students are there to support each other. Sometimes, though, there were a few students that have mentioned Students' Union services, such as the Peer Support Center, the Distress Helpline, and these are all very valuable services that I'm glad students are pushing. And if we could use effective communications, such as social media channels, to promote the SU and put the SU out there in a way that's not only convenient, accessible, but open and transparent to students, I think that students would be in a better position to tell us what they want, be more comfortable with the Students' Union as a larger organization, and really allow us to influence and
10 seconds.
Represent them. It'd be putting me in a better position then to not only defend student voice, support student health, but also strengthen community action. Please find more information at lauforlife.ca.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Mr. William Lau will have an opportunity to ask their opponent a question for 30 seconds if we can get Dylan to go to one of the mics over the side.
Thanks, Reid. Now, I know that there's a lot of emphasis put on the street team, but how can we make a street team more sustainable and what supports could we have for the volunteers so that it's an initiative that they want to take on throughout the year? Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much for the question. Now, I'm going to, first of all, plead a little bit of ignorance, and I'm sorry that I don't know Kevin's specific plan. But I would say, when you talk about sustainability, I think that probably the biggest thing is, how do you have people keep coming back and keep being part of the volunteer base or the street team base? And I would say that Kevin would definitely, first of all, look into volunteers. I think that it's possible to find people that do care enough about student life and do care enough about the events, and they're part of the organization of these events, that they're going to put up posters, they're going to do classroom talks, they're going to talk to people one-on-one, as well as Kevin himself. I know Kevin really, really cares about this, and I wouldn't put him put it past him to actually take it as a personal initiative upon himself.
Thank you. Mr. William Lau will have 1 minute to rebut.
Now, it's not I like to hear that he's willing to take it upon himself and do some of that groundwork too. But how can we ensure that a street team is something that that could be sustained not only this year, but from year to year onwards to continue that communications? Also, one of the flaws with the street team is that there's no feedback from the students. We're there dumping information at students, but what can we ask and how can we gather that feedback to figure out what students really want? I agree that street team and direct marketing is very efficient. I mean effective, not that efficient. But along with that, we really need to diversify our marketing methods and incorporate other things like social media that's there for students 24/7. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, candidate Kevin Smith or Mr. Dylan Hanwell, on behalf of candidate Kevin Smith, will have an opportunity to ask a question for 30 seconds.
Okay, so Mr. Lau, at the start of the campaign, you stated that with Break the Record, it should be the students who decide whether it should happen or not. Now it seems, just like Kevin, it's become a major platform point. Could you give us some explanation as to this change?
Well, I think it's interesting because Kevin and I chose to speak about Break the Record. It's because we're pretty sure it's going to happen. Whether or not Kevin steps into VPSL, whether I do it, whether any one of you steps up as VP Student Life, Break the Record is pretty much going to happen. And that's why we have that in our platform, because we know it's a promise that we could deliver, right? I guess that's politics. I'm not a politician, I'm a student, but. And yeah, hope that helps.
Thank you. Mr. Dylan Hanwell has 1 minute to rebut.
Okay, so thanks for the answer. That was good. I just think, though, that there's a conflict when we talk about engaging with students and talking with students and taking their ideas and seeing what they want versus just making those decisions and kind of seeing the response that you get after making those decisions. So I think Kevin has actually created a pretty strong platform and said that he wants to do it. And from that position, he's gotten a response from students instead of kind of changing a platform at the drop of a hat. I think Kevin's really created a strong platform from that base and engaged students on a much more meaningful level.
Thank you. All right. The next race will be the race for the Vice President Academic. Can we have Mr. Dustin Chellen on stage, please?
Hey everyone, so I don't want to give the message that I'm indecisive, but I have two speeches, and the standard one of what do I want to do, but also a bigger explanation of why do I want to do it. So question to you, hands up for what I want to do? Hands up for why I want to do it. Damn it. Yeah, so my name is Dustin, running for re-election as Vice President Academic of the Students' Union. I came from a high school down in Calgary, and I was always a pretty nerdy fellow, I have to admit. Loved math, loved science. But when I was 14, I also came out of the closet as being gay. And I lost a lot of friends because of that, and I didn't really fit in high school. And when I came to the University of Alberta, I had so many people that took me in with open arms. It didn't matter about that. What mattered is that I loved math. I joined a fraternity and they didn't care about it either. I love this place. I've never had a place where I felt more at home and I don't want to leave yet. please don't make me leave. But as VPA, I mean, I have the privilege that I can represent you as students, that I can make the university as important to you as it has been for me, and it's changed my life. It's a place that makes me feel like I belong. So yeah, that's why I want to do it. Platform, accessible textbooks, better teaching experiences, a less bureaucratic university. But ultimately, I want a compassionate university, a place where everyone feels at home, a place where everyone feels accepted, and something that means as much to each one of you as it does to me. So, thanks.
Thank you. All right. Next up is the race for the Vice President External. Can we have Mr. Adam Woods on stage, please?
Hi, everybody. Thank you very much for coming out today to the forum. My name's Adam Woods. I'm running for the position of Vice President External, which means that if I'm elected, I get to represent all you fine folks to the government, municipal, federal, provincial, the whole nine yards. I'm running on three main platform points, some of them new, some of them continuing on advocacy that we've tried and need to continue to attempt to do now. My first point, the new one, is regarding mental health. This is the first time that mental health has been brought up into the external portfolio, and I think that it is a very important piece of my platform and something that we continue to work on. The NCHA, the National College Health Assessment, there was one done at the U of A here, and it found that U of A students were most challenged in terms of mental health and most challenged in terms of emotional wellness. And recently, the government decided to give $10.4 million to all the public institutions across Alberta as a means of addressing this issue. Now, this funding is something that needs to continue, it's something that needs to be increased, and it's something that we need to continue receiving here at the U of A. At the end of the day, mental health only goes away when stress is gone, and being that we're at university, I don't think that's ever going to go away. That funding needs to be continuous. Two of the other things that I'm working on, and the Students' Union has worked on in the past, and I feel is very very important that we continue lobbying on, are first student employment. Now, when I had first prepared for this campaign, I had prepared a platform that was about improving Alberta's only summer student employment program. Now it's about replacing it, because it's getting cut. And this has been made quite clear to everybody through newspaper and through media. And it's important that we bring back this program. We're going to be the only province, including territories, including the Yukon and the Northwest Territories, without a student employment program, and we need to continue that. Finally, who here knows what a mandatory non-instructional fee is? Yay, that's like the best response I've gotten all week, and I'm very happy. This is the university's way of charging you tuition when they really shouldn't. In 2009, there was a tuition cap placed stating that the university couldn't charge you above CPI.
10 seconds.
We need to continue fighting the university to ensure they're not charging us in this kind of way, and I encourage you to ask questions about that because I didn't get really a good chance to address it. Please visit my website, www.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, next up is the race for the Vice President Operations and Finance. Can we have Mr. Josh Lay on stage, please?
Love you too, maybe. Okay. So I'll start off with a story. I had no clue what to expect coming into the Alberta School of Business a couple of years ago. But I knew that I wanted to enter the world of business because my eyes were open after doing my jeans experiment and seeing what's there to offer in the denim industry. And one of my friends, Nick, he told me this one quote that I thought was very obnoxious, and it says, "Business isn't everything." But over my BCom, I've learned that there's a certain level of truth to that statement. And if we look at the stage, for example, there was a business that harvested the raw material, another to transport it, to build it, and so on and so forth, to bring it to its final stage. But I can see thousands of businesses that brought us all here together in the Meyer Horowitz Theater. And we interact with businesses and brands on a daily basis, and it's a business that meets and fulfills our needs the best that wins our money. And I want to use my business skills and skill set and network and connections to make the SU businesses the ones that ultimately win our dollars. And my three platform points, it's to enhance SU businesses. There's 10 owned and operated SU businesses that we run, and some of them include Rat, Dewey's, Juicy, Cram Dunk, Separate, so on. But I have a theory that there's a cycle that as we increase more engagement with our businesses, we'll increase the profitability, and then that money will be used to increase the services, which will again increase more engagement, and the cycle goes on and on. And so I want to make sure that we get there. The next point is to champion the sub and PAW projects and to strengthen the communication channels with SU. And just for Ryan Bromsgrove on Twitter, sustainability, sustainability, sustainability.
Thank you. All right. Well, the next race will be the race for the president of the Students' Union. The first candidate is Horse with a Gun.
Can you hear me? You can hear me. This university is an ignorant glutton that has already ran past the precipice, suspended by disbelief only long enough for a weak murmur. I have seen the future, and if this rote charade persists, we will be little more than an underwater fart in a titanic glacial lake. Although I dress a full auditorium, I know that at best, only 20% of you will vote. This is not your fault. A politician is meant to be an individual of selflessness, of vision. Instead, you are brutalized by a wretched buffet of panhandling politicos. Long ago, you have grown sick and tired of offering up a pittance so your friend or your friend's friend can ride a boogie board on a tidal wave of bloated tuition into a year-long West Wing LARPing session. It's time to take off your mask, unzip your GIMP mask, and sever the phantom limb that is the students' union. I have seen the emperor. The emperor has no clothes because the emperor is a horse. I am horse with a gun! I am horse with a gun!
Ten seconds. Thank you. All right, the next candidate will be Mr. Petros Kuzmou. Sure, I would just cut you off.
On a winter day, 33 years ago, my parents, teenage refugees from a small, war-torn African country, came to Edmonton for their first time. Now, at the University of Alberta, my father was the first one from his family who got an education. International students and students from rural communities leave everything that they've known behind just to get an education here. And Aboriginal students and students from low-income families, they forever change the course of their family's future by getting an education here. Now, post-secondary education is simply more than the vehicle for social mobility, but it is also a catalyst for transformative change. Now, us students, we have a choice. We can choose to begrudgingly accept whatever we have been told and allow apathy and pessimism to chain us down to an uninspiring world. We can do that, but we can do so much more. We are not the leaders of tomorrow, but we are the leaders for today. We can make the change that we want to see in the world now. And the change starts here. Change starts with student groups that engage students, disengage students, and turn them to active leaders. Change starts with residence associations and Greek societies that encourage students to be active citizens of society. And change starts with students who decide to get out of their comfort zone and give back to their communities and give back to themselves. Change starts with us, and it starts with you. Now, as Barack Obama once said, change will come... Change will come, change will not come by one person, or we cannot wait for change to come by one person, or we can't say to come for another time. We are the ones that we've been waiting for. So instead of listing off my platform today, and instead of just listing off my resume, I just wanted to leave you guys with that one idea, that we are able to bring the change that we want to see, and that hoping for change is good, but acting on it is even better. Now, one of the things that I want to be able to do is to ensure that we have a lot more of an active students' union, and that we can be able to
thank
bring change
you.
As well. So
thank
please
you.
Vote for Petros
la,
Kuzmou.
La, 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 la. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next up is Mr. Sadiq Sumar. Yep.
Good afternoon, everyone. During my time on campus, I've invested myself in contributing to a better undergraduate experience. As a floor coordinator and a hall vice president in Lister, I created an inclusive atmosphere in the community so that students excelled. As your vice president's student life, I negotiated to reduce the proposed price of the UPass. When I was concerned about student mental health issues, I worked to create puppy rooms. And as your president, I will work to ensure that your voice continues to be heard, whether it be on issues like residence changes or student fees. I have tangible experience working on both of these issues, unlike the other candidates, and have been a representative for ongoing priorities such as the SU Health and Dental Plan and the sub-renovations project. I have delivered on my previous campaign promises and continue to be accountable to students. As president, I will continue to fight rent increases and to erode the mandatory nature of the meal plan. I will continue to champion mental health issues and expand programming and activities during reading week. I've heard students who are concerned about environmental and social sustainability, and I plan to initiate a sub-food court waste audit and engage in consultation for the creation of gender-neutral washrooms in sub to create a more inclusive and accepting atmosphere. This past year as an SU executive, I have proven myself and have taken tangible action to ensure that my goals are accomplished. As president, I will continue to be accountable and accessible to students. Voting this Wednesday and Thursday for me, Sadiq Sumar, to be your next SU president ensures that students' concerns will not only be heard, but acted upon. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, Sadiq, I'll get Sadiq Sumar to stay right there. Can we get the other two candidates to stand on the other two mics for the cross-examination? All right, Mr. Sadiq Sumar will have 30 seconds to ask his opponents a question. The first to answer will be Horse with a Gun, and after that will be Petros Kuzmu.
Executives need to be transparent and should be held accountable for their election promises by the student body. If elected, how do you plan on following through on your platform points instead of making them just promises?
I would like to respond to your question with a quote of my own from Revelation 6:12. And the sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Petros Kuzmu. You have 1 minute.
That's an excellent question, and that's exactly why I made a 31-page platform document with 66 citations that clearly outlines how I'm going to accomplish each and every single promise that I've made if elected president. So in terms of what strategy do I have, well, I mean, I could go through all the goals and promises that I've made, but we're only allowed 30 seconds to talk. So I encourage you to go on my website, votepetros.com, to actually see the tangible steps I want to be able to take if elected president to complete my goals. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Now, Mr. Petros Kuzmu will have a chance to ask a question.
Rebuttal? Is there time for a rebuttal?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
1 minute Thanks, rebuttal. Fareed. I apologize for that.
No worries. Thanks, Fareed. Takes the edge off at the Horowitz. Calm down. Okay.
In this past year, I have delivered successful results when negotiating the UPass price, when creating alternative programming like the Campus Musical, Comedy Nights, and their singer-songwriter series with the help of the PNV staff, when resolving the Golden Bears and Pandas legacy fund issues, when working to reduce rent increases, support the farmers market, and advocate on a number of their promises, and advocate for more microwaves. Ugh. In comparison, other presidential candidates have failed to deliver on a number of their promises, including creating plebiscite questions on fees and campus tours for MLAs. These have been goals that have been established months ago that they were supposed to have delivered on and completed in the fall. I have proven my history of upholding my executive promises, and voting for me continues to support accountable executives. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Can we get Mr. Petros Kuzmu in the middle podium, please? Yes. Mr. Petros Kuzmu will have a chance to ask a question that is 30 seconds long. The first to answer will be Sadiq Sumar, and after that will be Horse with a Gun.
Awesome. Thanks a lot for the question. So first off, I'd recommend you go over my executive goals just to make sure that what you've said was completely true. But the second thing is in regards to international students. I was just wondering, what are your plans for advocating for international students? How are you going to better them? Because if it wasn't for international students, I wouldn't be here today. So.
Thank you. We'll start with Mr. Sadiq Sumar.
Thank you very much. I think if you also had a chance to review my platform goals, working with Vice President Academic Dustin Schellen, we have been working on this past year to develop two different committees for the International Students Association. Unfortunately, we've hit a short snag in the membership of the committee. We're still working through that, but we're making sure that we put the sort of international advocacy issues just as much in our hands as in international students' hands. Who knows international student issues better than international students themselves? Who knows that better than international students? Honestly, as a domestic student, I know a few international student issues, but I don't know all of them. I know that tuition differential is something that's important, something that's huge. It's something that we need to advocate on and that we do advocate on and that I will advocate on. But working with the Vice President Academic, Dustin Schellen, we have been working on International Student Association, and I fully intend to complete this goal
10 seconds.
Before the end of my term as Vice President Student Life. And if not, to continue this goal into my presidential year if elected. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, Horse with a Gun will have 1 minute to respond.
For millennia, horses, equine, were the dominant species on the planet Earth. I suggest that we reform all the continents into a veritable new world Pangea, where international students are no longer a question. We will not know borders or discrimination. We will be holding hands in a massive peace sign on one land, one earth, where we will all be screaming to the heavens, I am one with all!
Thank you. All right, Mr. Petros Kuzmu will have 1 minute to rebut.
How do you even follow up with that? Jesus. I think what you just said is a really interesting proposal, and I think that's awesome to work on. But I think there's also more tangible ways that we can actually work to better the international student experience here on campus. One of them is ensuring and that making sure that we can make it easier for them to become permanent residents of here in Canada. Now, our federal advocacy organization, CASA, is trying to ask the federal government to increase and make it easier for international students to become permanent residents here, but only for graduate students. If elected president, one of the things I want to focus on is if we can expand that scope for undergraduate international students so it can be easier for them to become permanent residences once they finish graduation. I think that's one tangible way that international students could benefit from my platform, and I feel like that's something that they would extremely appreciate it. So,
thank you. All right, can we get Horse with a Gun to the middle podium, please? All right, you have Horse with a Gun has 30 seconds to ask a question.
Now, it may stun all of you to hear that horse enrollment at the University of Alberta has been zero for the past 3 years. In fact, there has only ever been one horse enrolled at the university, and it has been me. So my question to you is, what do you plan on doing to encourage campus diversity?
Thank you. All right. First person to answer the question will be Mr. Petros Kuzmu.
Thank you for the excellent question, and I feel like that's the role of the provincial government. They need to be giving more needs-based grants to all students so they can be in a more of an accessible post-secondary education system here in Alberta. And I have a question for you. Did you get a scholarship or a grant to come to university? Are you eligible for student loans? I don't know, and I don't know if that's the case, and I feel like that's a good way starting point for encouraging more of you and your kind to be here at the U of A.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Sadiq Sumar.
Well, over the course of this past week, I feel like I've seen a lot more than just one horse on campus, so I feel like there's more of you than just one. So take a look around, maybe right beside you. I don't know if that's a horse or if that's just an assistant to the horse. Also, with all the people in the signs with their assistant to the, or I am the real horse with a gun signs, yes, maybe those people are actually horse with a gun. Anyways. Moving on to student diversity, I think Petros is absolutely right, but I think we also need to do what we can from our end to make sure that the University of Alberta is accessible in our own institution, to make sure that this institution is accessible to rural students, to Aboriginal students, any underrepresented groups on our campus. We need to work with CAUSE, we need to work with our federal lobby groups, Yes, but we also need to work within our own institution to do that. And that's something that I also want to work on next year as your SU president. Thank
you. 10 seconds. Thank you. All right. Now, Horse with a Gun will have a 1 minute rebuttal.
First of all, I choose to ignore the nearly dripping, vitriolic, discriminatory phrase of your kind. I am an equal. I demand rights. And to answer your question, I tried to apply for scholarships, but I have hooves, so I can't write. I can't type. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Well, those are the opening speeches. We'll now have the mics open. Sorry. Oh, UPass again. My apologies. We have a representative for the UPass yes referendum. Two minutes.
So I decided to pull a move that's circa Petros Kuzmu 2012 and tell you all a story today. So my name is Colton Yamagishi, and I'm representing the UPass Yes campaign. And I'm here today to ask you a very simple question. What does the UPass mean to you? So Aaron Borden, what does the UPass mean to you? Yes. You're wrong. Kian Hackett, what does the UPass mean to you? No, that's absolutely way off. The UPass simply represents your freedom. What do I mean by this? The freedom for universal access to Edmonton Transit Services, St. Albert Transit, and transit in Strathcona County. We give you a UPass in not only the fall and winter term, but this year, the introduction of the spring-summer UPass. Yeah, yeah. And most importantly, never forget this, the freedom to not have the fear and suffering of the ETS cop coming to give you a $250 ticket for not having your pass. UPass is wonderful. Now it's time to do some simple math. The new UPass contract spells out the need for this amount of money, 2013, 2014, 122, 92, 2014, 2015, 129, 17, 15, 16, 135, 42, and 2016, 2017, 141, 67. The average round trip on transit costs $6.40. With some simple division, you'll find that you only need to take 19 trips per semester to get your money's worth. And the regular adult pass for 1 month is $89. $30 more gets you 4 months? What a deal. Fantastic.
10 seconds.
And if you work for ETS, you can have a disability preventing you from transit or on a work experience term, you do not have to pay it. So when you get up to the polls, think of this one difficult question. Is your freedom
Thank
worth
you.
$122?
Thank you. All right, so we'll start with the questions for candidates now. Like I said earlier, if you're asking a question for the president or the vice president student life race, please use the mic on this side. If you're asking a question for any of the other races, please use the mic on that side. If you don't have any questions, then I will ask questions, and I can assure you, like I've assured you before, that they are extremely boring. So please go ask questions, and we also are accepting questions from Twitter.
Hello, I have a question for the Vice President of Student Life. It seems to be a trend that they then run for president, so I'm wondering what your plans are for the next year. Will you be planning to run for president too?
All right,
do you know Kevin's
we
plan?
Will start with Mr. Dylan Hanwell on behalf of Kevin Smith.
Okay, so first of all, I think getting inside Kevin Smith's head is a little hard for me. So unfortunately, I can't say that. From the times that I've talked to him about it, I don't actually think that he's interested in it. He's actually, the reason he's gone is he's doing his APT right now, so I'm pretty sure that he kind of wants, after being VP Student Life, he'd probably want to get on with his professional degree and move on to something different after that. So no, I don't think he'll be running for president.
Thank you. Next up is candidate William Lau.
I've applied for my master's this year in public health with a specialization in health policy and management. And that's something that I'm really looking forward to, acceptance letters or a notification of acceptance will be in at the end of March. And I guess this is the only thing that I would drop my master's for, and after this year, I would definitely apply again and look forward to attaining my master's there. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we'll take a question from this side of the stage.
So my question is for the BOG race. So in your speech today, you mentioned the mandatory tabling for council reps, and I'm just wondering, in your role as a BOG rep, where you represent the student voice of the Board of Governors, is that under your portfolio, and would this not be better suited for the student life?
Absolutely, thank you, great question. You're right that I do sit on the Board of Governors, but I also sit on Students' Council, and I'm a fully elected and accountable counselor in that regard. So I felt it would be actually inappropriate to not include an element in my platform that also addressed Students' Council. Just as the Board of Governors obviously is extremely important and is the focus of the position, but so too is it important for the Board of Governors representative to have an active and involved presence on council. And so that's the reason why I included that initiative. So, thank you.
Thank you. We'll take a question from this side of the stage.
Thank you. So, to the president race, during the debate there was some critique of not getting platform goals done. So my question is, what have you done to keep each other accountable? Because as president, you're going to be in charge of keeping four other BPs accountable. So I want to hear, instead of just critiquing each other, what have you done to make each other better?
Thank you. First person to answer will be Mr. Sadiq Sumar. Can we get all three candidates on the stage to make this quicker? Yeah, first person is Mr. Sadiq Sumar.
Thank you. One thing that I know that I've harped a lot on Colton about is a few of the different points that he's made sure to sort of emphasize, but sometimes takes a little bit longer to follow through on. I think as a full executive team, I should say, I think we've all been on his case and we've all been on each other's cases to make sure that we all do accomplish our goals. Furthermore, I think the best means of holding executives accountable is Students' Council. When we have engaged students' counselors, when we have student counselors like yourself, Jason, coming out to student council meetings and questioning us during question period and making sure that we are held accountable to our executive goals, that is the best way to hold us accountable. And something that I want to do next year as president in talking to a few former presidents is make sure to put pressure on the executive team
10 seconds.
To make sure that they also hold up their end of the deal for when they got elected. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Horse with a Gun.
I suggest a system of vindictive retribution where the entire student's unit is hooked up to electrodes that lead to the one card of each and every individual at the University of Alberta. If you don't like what we're doing, press a button and a 10,000 volt shock will surge through our body. It is the perfect way to let us know that we have not been serving you as well as we should be. It is not only on us to keep ourselves in line, but it is on you. Rise up and take the autonomy that you deserve and deliver that electric shock.
Thank you. All right, next up is Mr. Petros Kuzmin.
I think just before I answer that question, it's important to clarify, one of my campaign promises is still in the works, and the other one was actually never a campaign promise. It was something that just kind of came up during my goals. But to answer a question of how we'll keep the other executives accountable, I feel like it's important to essentially regularly follow up with them, try and find ways we can collaborate earlier, and try to focus on us publishing our executive goals, perhaps earlier than the stated deadline within the strategic plan. I think that's pretty important as well. The second way we can ensure that executives are accountable and that our goals are, we're keeping each other's to account, is by trying to find ways to better engage student counselors as well so they can be a lot more informative as to what's going on in our respective portfolios. Trying to find ways to reform students' council, I think, is imperative for us having a lot more of an accountable students' union as a whole. So,
thank you. All right, we'll take a question from this side of the stage.
Thank you. My question is actually for Board of Governors Representative Brent Kelly. So I apologize because this is a bit of a tricky question, but in your speech you spoke to how students don't have enough information on how to get engaged with student governance on campus. In my specific faculty association for the Faculty of Arts, we have strived to engage student involvement with limited success. One of these methods has been tabling. Can you speak specifically to your faculty, which is our faculty, the Faculty of Arts, what we've been doing that has been unsuccessful?
Thank you for the question. It's a great question. I think the Undergraduate Board of Governors representative position represents students at large, the entire undergraduate student body. I'm not terribly familiar with the Arch Undergraduate Students Association in terms of what they've been trying to do to get involved, to get students involved. But just generally speaking, I don't think in general the Students' Union or Faculty Associations or the university has done nearly enough to get undergraduate students involved and aware with what's going on in terms of student governance and university governance. And that's why I think my initiative is a really great opportunity to give students the opportunity to connect one-on-one with their representatives on a regular basis, but also give them the resources so if they want to get more involved, they can ask somebody who already is, right? Because as it kind of works now, it's if you ask a friend who's involved,
10 seconds,
then you can get involved, but it's very inaccessible to the average person. So thanks for the question.
Thank you.
All right, we'll take a question from this side of the stage.
Hello, this is a question for all presidential candidates. So, the desire for an effective and collaborative sharing space between governance and students has been reflected in resentment towards Lister Hall changes, frustration over lack of student group consultation in the sub-renovations, and I think also in the call for a more gender-balanced executive election. So how, as leader of our university's students, will you catalyze the changes needed for improvements in the relationship between students and governing bodies? And just as importantly, how will you evaluate the success and failure of your actions? Thanks.
Thank you. All right, the first person to answer will be Mr. Petros Kuzmu. Yeah, it would be faster if everyone comes up. Go.
Am I starting?
Yeah.
Great. So I didn't get a chance to completely hear everything that you had to say, but I feel like I kind of get the gist of it, of how we're going to better engage our student governance, the Students' Union, with the students and with student groups, and ensuring that their voices are heard. And how are we going to measure that exactly? And again, like I've said this before, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but I feel like ways that we can, by us critically analyzing the Students' Union as it is, Students' Council, trying to find ways we can better empower counselors, is going to be a good first step in trying to see if we can encourage students representative and engagement with the student groups as well. In terms of metrics of how we're going to do that, I feel like one way to keep some sense of accountability is encourage counselors to actually come up with their own annual goals. Executives also do the same thing. Why not our own counselors and representatives? And I think that's an idea to start considering. Not to say we should implement it right away, but consult with other members of Students' Council and other stakeholders and see if this is a worthwhile idea.
10 seconds.
So in terms of metrics, I feel like that's a really good way that we can address the issue that you raised.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Sadiq Sumar.
Thank you. So in terms of, just like Petros, I think I didn't get the full question, but hopefully I got the gist of the question. In terms of relationships with governing bodies, I think it's important to have regular meetings with university administrators, with members of the Board of Governors, and just develop a sense of collaboration on our campus. I think I couldn't have said it better than Board of Governors Representative Brent Kelly when he said that we need to sort of continue to build that collaboration within the board, and I think that extends to university administration as well. And I think consultation is an important part of what the Students' Union does. I think in terms of the sub-renovations project, or even potentially the gender-neutral washrooms issue, it's important to make sure that we have good consultation with student groups so that everyone is at ease with what is being proposed.
In terms
of metrics, I think the best metric is the students, is Students' Council. Talking to counselors and making sure that counselors are happy with what's going on, and making sure that students are also happy with what's going on.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right, next up is Ms. Candidate Horse with a Gun.
I will demolish the aristocratic elitist cabal that is the Students' Union. There won't be a question of accountability. There won't be a question of listening to the student body. There will only be one grand leader, and he will be a horse. I will trot daily through the pastures, listening to your words, your sweet whispers in your dandelion mouths, and I will say yay, and I may say nay, but I will be there in the greener pasture of tomorrow.
Thank you. All right, we'll take a question from this side of the stage. Can you tell us which race is this going to?
My question is directed towards the VPA race.
All right, the Vice President Academic race. Go ahead.
So my question has to do with faculty associations, which is under your portfolio, because you didn't really mention any platform points about it in your speech. How do you plan on supporting the FAs and their diverse needs, since they represent such different student bodies, and their unique ability to represent their students' voice also as elected officials?
Yeah, thanks for the awesome question. I'm sorry that I didn't have an opportunity to address it in my platform statement. I'll start by saying I love and hate FAs. I started my own faculty association in science with the help of a large group of students, the Interdepartmental Science Student Society, and spent 2 years working on developing it. It's a labor of love. It takes up a lot of time. And so as VPA this year, I've invested my efforts in addressing barriers to faculty associations, be it financial barriers, working relationships with the deanery, or even engaging with your members at large. A second term will allow me to build closer working relationships so that I can continue to support faculty associations in understanding their unique needs. There's 14 of you on campus, and it's, I found it difficult to get a sense of exactly what I can do to best support each of you, but I'd like to build a record to ensure that the SU has an idea of what we can do to support you, and then continue to build the relationship from there. But thanks.
Thank you. All right, which race is your question directed to?
VPA Student Life.
All right, go ahead.
All right. In a comment to the Gateway, William Lau said that he didn't want to publicize one of his platform points because it, quote, might seem kind of vile, but sometimes you have to do vile things to get people's attention, end quote.
Sorry, I won't allow that question. If it's directed to one candidate, I won't allow it.
Well, Kevin Smith can respond if he wants to.
Phrase it differently or don't ask it.
Okay. Well, yeah, I just wanted to wonder if you could clarify about that, and what does Kevin Smith think about that?
Yeah. I'll take another question from this side. I won't allow a question that is directed to one candidate.
I don't mind.
Doesn't matter. Next question. Yeah.
Hey, so this question is for the VPSLs too. So as VPSL, one of your roles is to sit on the board of directors of the Campus Food Bank. So this question is on behalf of our membership. So I was just wondering, what's one initiative or strategy you would do as VPSL and as a board member for our agency to ensure to help reduce student poverty and food insecurity on campus?
Thank you. First person to answer will be Mr. William Lau.
Thanks, Fareed, and thanks, Mark. I could actually tie that back a little bit to a vile plan. What if the vision was to eliminate the campus food bank, right? What if we could build a community here where students don't have to rely on a campus food bank, and we can all be, you know, have access to affordable food and not have the financial strains that put us in that type of environment and that situation. I think as VP Student Life, one thing I'd like to do is actually something connected to City's point, and it's, you know, evaluating our waste on campus, whether it's with food vendors on campus or with events that are held on campus that would result in food wastage. I think that's something we should reevaluate and offer a service for these different types of events and venues to bring their food to a place after hours so that food can be redistributed on campus.
10 seconds.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Kevin Smith, represented by Dylan Hanwell.
Okay, so great question. Sorry, pardon my notes. I just need to look at some of the things that Kevin's put in his platform. One of the biggest things, I think, is he's creating a strategic plan so that SU organizations and student groups can collaborate with each other. So you have a lot of student groups and a lot of organizations within the Students' Union that do have mutual interests and that the Campus Food Bank specifically can benefit from. So this strategic plan not only facilitates a collaboration between those groups, but it also kind of looks into things like the sub-renovation plan and what can be done as a way that the Campus Food Bank can become bigger, can become more empowered, can help every student it needs to. So the strategic plan is probably the best answer to your question.
Thank you. All right, we'll take a question from this side of the stage. Which race is it directed to?
President.
President and Vice President Student Life questions are here.
Can I ask?
All right, next person.
Hi, my question's directed to the VP external candidate.
All right.
All right.
So the push to regulate mandatory non-instructional fees has been a goal of VPX candidates for what is now the third year in a row. Why is this still an issue? Has no progress been made in 2 years' time? Why has no progress been made? What do you plan to do differently this year that MINFs are at least regulated? I mean, I can only wait so long before me and nearly everyone start to lose their patience and drive to support this initiative.
Thanks. It's a great question, and truthfully, I think we should start losing our patience. It is quite the issue, and the reason that it's continuing is simply because progress has been made, but not progress enough that we've fixed the issue, and a lot of it has to do with the government. I mean, a few years ago, a current CRO was a VP external. He was lobbying Minister Greg Wedek. Greg Wedek was gone in the election. VP Kuzmu started to lobby Minister Khan. Minister Khan's now gone. Now we have Minister Luke Hazuk. It's been a change-up of politicians who are continually, you know, they're groups that you have to keep emphasizing the issue to and re-emphasizing it and ensuring them that this is a problem with us and that it's not something that's just going to go away. So long as these fees are still an issue and so long as the university is still making fees or charging us for things that they really shouldn't be, like the COS fee, for example. And I mean, there are a lot of mandatory instructional fees that aren't necessarily bad. You all pay about $60 a semester for a gym membership. That's not bad at all. But it's about ensuring that those that are a little bit unethical are voted on
Thank
by the
you.
Students.
Thank you. All right. Which race is your question directed to?
To VP Student Life.
All right. Can we get a question for the race for president before yours?
Sure. Absolutely.
All right. Whoever's the next person in line.
Hey, so my question is going to be directed toward the presidential candidates. For all you guys who aren't SU hacks, the SU strategic plan is going to be up next year. So I just want to know what your guys' vision for the SU strategic plan in the upcoming years is going to be, as well as how are you going to work to consult students on what they want their SU to be, and what do you see the role of social justice being in the SU strategic plan upcoming? Thank you.
Thank you. The order for answering this question will be Horse with a Gun, Petros Kuzmu, and then Sadiq Sumar.
Excellent question. I will demolish the Students' Union! These won't be questions anymore! That is the answer, not a simple band-aid solution over the gaping flesh wound of our gangrenous institution. No! I say we lop off that leg, buy a prosthetic, and run, run, run towards the finish line. It's the Olympics of life, and we are Oscar Pistorius pre-murder. Before he killed that person. He was good up until then.
Thank you. Next up will be Petros Kuzmu.
Oh, God. Okay. So in regards to the strategic plan, there are three points that I'll address. First is in regards to what are some of the changes that I'd like to see in it. I think one of the changes I want to start seeing into it is, again, better empowering counselors and finding a way we can reform counsel to better engage counselors with the respective portfolios as well. One of the ideas that I brought up in the past is let's try and see and look into if counselors should have annual goals. That's a good way to have metrics and ensure accountability for everybody else as well. So the second point is, how are we going to do this exactly? How are we going to consult with students? I think that's an excellent question as well. Trying to find innovative ways and perhaps collaborating with the student life and the VP academic as well, and trying to communicate that with faculty associations and student groups is a strategy that I'm looking into. And being proactive and trying to approach specific communities on campus is important as well. The third point is in regards to social justice. As someone who's ran various social justice slates in the past, that's an issue that I'm passionate about as well. I think we can better define social justice in the strategic plan. Talking to past President Nick DeHaan, he told me this is something that was kind of left out last week.
Thank you.
I think
you.
This is something we can
Thank
do.
You.
So thanks.
Thank you. All right, next up is Sadiq.
I think that my answer to the first question to the third question are both the same. I think social sustainability or social justice needs to play a much more important role within the strategic plan. I think currently it's only mentioned once or twice, and there really isn't a good definition. And when looking at it on an SU policy perspective, policy committee had real struggles with defining what social justice or social sustainability would be. So I think one thing that I'd like to focus on is better defining that within the strategic plan. The second thing is to actually have more tangible goals to work towards. I think right now we just see general themes or things we should be working on or things like that. I think we also need to have an end goal by the end of 4 or 5 years to say that the SU should have accomplished this in the next 4 or 5 years. And I think that is the role of the president to do, is
10
to
seconds.
Direct the vision of the students' union. In terms of consultation, a little bit similar to what happened last year, but consulting with Students' Council, I think, is extremely important, and with students as well.
Thank you. All right. Do we have any questions that are not for President or Student Life? No. Do we have any from Twitter? All right.
Okay, so I have a question for the VP External. Past execs have been unsuccessful in getting rid of mandatory non-instructional fees. What will you do differently?
No, that's basically the same question.
Yeah.
Do you have anything else?
A bit, yeah, I can answer it. But. Make one up for Reed.
All right, we have a question for OpsFi.
Sorry about that. I've been looking at my phone too much and not listening. So a question for OpsFi. What SU businesses do you believe will deserve your attention first, and why?
Thank you. Thanks, Zach Fentman, for asking that question. I felt a bit lonely up here. The first SU business that will require my attention is Dewey's. It's at the heart of campus, and it's a very, underutilized service, and it's not running at its full efficiency and effectiveness. And so I think that we can go from there. It's already in motion. There's talks already with the SU and the U of A to make it a better space. And yeah, so we'll look at Dewey's first because it's already underway and the rest of the businesses will follow suit. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, I believe you have a question for
VP Student Life.
VP Student Life, go ahead.
So my question would be, as the current VP Student Life has failed to deliver certain promises, like having a huge campus music festival, or even bother to do another record for Dodgeball at all. So my question would be, what's your plans going to be to fulfill the promises and follow up with your old plans? Thank you.
Thank you. First up will be Dylan Hanwell on behalf of Kevin Smith.
Okay, that's a really good question. And I think Kevin has a really awesome kind of response to this. And it's that he just released his kind of 31-day plan, we'll call it, kind of synonymous to the 100-day plan for American presidents. I have in front of me a list of meetings and of kind of things that he'd like to do in the first 31 days of his term. So for, obviously you have the goals document that you're going to be doing, which he has on here, submitted goals document on May 31st, but he has talks with the LHSA, he has a meeting with the Vice President of Facilities and Operations, the University of Alberta Protective Services. Kevin has kind of a strategic plan, even in the first 31 days that he wants to fulfill. So I think that actually surpasses just something like the goals document that
seconds.
You usually see.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. William Lau.
Thank you. And I think it's interesting because I think every candidate up here has been careful in selecting their promises and selecting their goals to make sure that they are somewhat attainable. As for booking meetings, that's something that's a little bit more difficult because, it's not a meeting with yourself, it's a meeting with someone else. And because of that, it's hard to set concrete dates and assume that the other party will be free at a specific day or time. But as for holding myself accountable then. Break the record is something that will be planned within the next month, or the planning process will start to begin. And again, like I mentioned before, that is something that will be planned almost regardless of who the VPSL is. Next up, I talked earlier too a little bit about a case competition that I'd like to start for students, and that would be for students to form teams to solve the problem of campus and student engagement. And fortunately, there is a model out there currently on campus that I could make use of. And I would have access to that right away, and planning wouldn't take more than 2 months.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, we have a question from Twitter to the Vice President Academic.
So the question is, which initiatives from the past year have been successful or unsuccessful, and which will you continue with?
Thanks for the question. I think The VPA portfolio is a little bit different from other portfolios. It's not necessarily just a one-year term. You have to work on projects for multiple years. So I continued projects like working on the undergraduate research symposium from my predecessor, or continuing to work on graduate student attributes. I think the biggest disappointment out of my term is a grading policy that went through at the very beginning that was slightly unclear for students, and I think wasn't as good as it could be. That being said, it was sort of thrown on me 7 days into my term. So I think, in all honesty, that was my biggest failure over the course of the year. Overall, I'll continue to work on successes like restarting the conversation on the evaluation of teaching, connecting more professors with the Center for Teaching and Learning, and working with the bookstore to address high-cost textbooks. So I wouldn't say that overall there were many failures in my portfolio, just conversations that are going a little bit longer than I'd hoped. But thanks for the question.
Thank you. All right. What race is your question directed to?
To the president.
All right, go ahead.
So my question is addressed to presidential candidates Petros and Sadiq.
You can't, you, all...
Okay, then we'll
yeah,
do all.
Yeah, everyone will have to answer.
Just... Right. So in a 2012 study, the Justice Center for Constitutional Freedoms produced a paper called The State of Campus Free Speech in 2012 and rated the University of Alberta's constitution in the bottom third for campus free speech, particularly in the section governing the ability of students and students' groups to distribute publications. Specifically, all publications must be in good taste and relevant to the needs of the student population. They rated this category as a D and said that because it had no specifics as to what was in good taste. And it highlights that our constitution is not specific enough and could be misinterpreted. So my question to the presidential candidates is, if elected, when or what measures will you take to ensure that our constitution is ironclad against the abuses of authority?
Thank you. The first person to answer the speaking order will be Sadiq Sumar, Horst Udagan, and then Petros Kuzmu.
That's a very excellent question and a very difficult one to answer. I think you had emailed me about that, and I haven't had a chance. It was just last night. I haven't had a chance to review your email. I believe it was last night. Correct me if I'm wrong. But I do fully intend to actually read the reasons why we got such a low grade on this. And I think what we really need to do is we need to build a much better relationship with the administration and with the Board of Governors, like I've been saying, so that we don't face abuses of our constitution. And I think within the Students' Union, we also need to take measures as well. I think one thing we need to do is actually make the constitution a little bit more transparent. We need to show students what's actually in there. We also need to communicate with students about what we plan on doing this year, and I think we need to communicate that a little bit better. I think elections is the first step, but I think we need to continue to follow up with students, student leaders as well to make sure that we do a good job of representing them when doing our jobs as student leaders. We represent students, so we should also be listening to them. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Horst Udagan.
I too received your email. Unlike my esteemed opponent here, I actually did read it. And I agree, absolutely. The Constitution has long been a tool of subjugation, able to be misinterpreted, used, and abused by the technocrats in power, slinging their iPods all around and stuff. Kind of lost my train of thought. I've been yelling a lot, and I'm feeling pretty hoarse.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Petros Kuzmu.
How can you have a healthy, efficient, and effective democracy if you don't constantly reanalyze and look at it and critically see if there are ways to improve it? And that's one of my major platform points of looking at ways we can improve Students' Council as a whole Students' Union as well. But in regards to your particular statements, I feel like during this, you know, self-analytical process, I feel like we need to ensure that we're consulting with folks beyond Students' Council and as well, stakeholders like yourself, so students can raise these concerns and we can be able to put this on the radar and say, okay, what can we do about this? In addition to that, I feel like it's important to talk to the university as well and see if there are ways we can improve our freedom of speech on campus. And that's essentially it, making sure that we can reform ourselves and better ourselves so we're a lot more of an effective organization.
10 seconds. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a question from this side? No. I believe we have a question for the Vice President External.
So for the Vice President External, what is your vision for the advocacy training program?
That's an excellent question. I always love the opportunity to talk about some of the smaller platform issues that I'm running on, and one of them is the external advocacy team, which is something that I actually ran on last year when I was running for this position, and has actually been worked on throughout the year. Essentially, for the last couple of years now, the Students' Union has been holding lobby training, where we try to get students who are, you know, engaged in campus, and or maybe a lot of them not even that engaged in campus, who are interested in lobbying politicians on issues that matter to students. And we spent the last 2 years now getting students trained and trying to relay the principles of good lobbying onto them. I think it is now time that we could actually take some of these students into lobby meetings with provincial MLAs and city officials as well. I think that in the next year, this is more than feasible, and I look forward to hopefully having a few of my peers actually come with me to these meetings. I think it's a lot more effective when you walk into the room with three or four of you instead of just one or two of you.
10 seconds.
Especially when there's as many empowered and well-spoken students as there are on this campus. I feel that we get a lot more of our lobby points across if we had more.
Thank you.
Just keep cutting me off.
All right. What race are you asking?
I'd like to ask the president and the UPass race.
Okay. Is there anyone? Can you ask the UPass question?
It's combined.
The only one race.
Okay, I'll ask the president.
And I'll get someone to ask Vice President Student Life before you.
Oh, okay. My question is to the Vice President Student Life. Campaigns often reflect how an executive will represent their students. How do you feel your platform, or lack thereof, represents a transparent student union that seeks feedback from the students?
Thank you. First to answer the question will be Mr. William Lau.
Great question. Just like everyone's saying, right? And I think...
Yeah, thank you. And I think along with that, transparency is something that students want, right? Or that's what we feel that students want. Except the papers are all online already. A lot of the meeting minutes are there, and if students wanted to learn more about what the Students' Union is doing, the information is there. Unfortunately, you know, it's a few clicks away, and what can we do to make it one click away? I think social media is a great way to get information out to students. And again, even if they don't choose to read it, if it was something that was to show up on their news feed, at least they'd be aware that the information is available, right? Even right now, if we told students that the minutes are online, information's there, and that you could, you know, check out the SU website, how many students are actually going to do that? Not many.
10 seconds.
And again, that goes back to finding different ways of delivering messages that'll be more effective. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Kevin Smith, represented by Dylan Hanwell.
Okay, thanks for the question. I think that what I talked about in the last question, first of all, really shows transparency with Kevin. And he has specific plans that there's dates in which they should be fulfilled. Also, when you talk about his platform, he's stayed consistent with his platform, and he stayed consistently open with his platform. So in Gateway interviews, in CJSR interviews, in forums, in one-on-ones, whatever you want, his platform has stayed the same. His platform has been open to anyone that asks. I think this will still be maintained. And if you are interested, please look at the Gateway interviews. Please look at his platform and talk to him, because I think you'll see that there is transparency in his platform and in his message.
Thank you. All right. We have a question from this side. What race?
Ops Phi.
All right, go ahead.
So my question is for the Ops Phi race. I was wondering what your thoughts are on where campus bars fall on the spectrum of a business and a service. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Joshley has 1 minute to respond.
Oh, sorry, can you answer say that question?
The question was regarding where does campus bars lie on the spectrum between service and business? Am I correct?
Yep.
All right.
Yeah, thank you for that question, Corey. I think it's a philosophical question where you balance between a service and a business. And where I lie on is that in order, or for a service that is effectively used, it is also a profitable business because it meets the need that a student wants. And if the student wants it, they will engage into that business and thus have a more profitable business. Does that answer your question? He shrugs
seconds.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we have a question
For the presidential race.
All right, go ahead.
There's been a lot of talk about platforms today.
sustainability platforms, tuition platforms, diversity. But the one platform that's been strikingly absent from this debate is the University Station LRT platform and the escalators that are perpetually broken. So let me ask you this. What is your platform? What will you do to uplift the whole people out of University Station? Is there a light at the end of this tunnel? Thank you.
Thank you. All right. The speaking order will be Petro, Sadiq, horse with a gun.
As someone who frequently uses the LRT, I've been noticing this issue for quite a number of months now. As president, now I'll have the opportunity to actually be able to deal with this because it falls underneath not only my portfolio, but the vice president's student life portfolio. I don't see why we can't simply talk about this with ETS and try and see if we can make some progress with them as well. Perhaps even talk to the university and try and see if we can almost have a joint fronted advocacy effort in trying to improve the escalators that we have in the LRT platform. So that's my platform. Let's get it done.
Thank you. Next up is Sadiq.
Great troll question, Vice President of Operations Finance Chima. Sorry. I think that's a really interesting point, and I think what we need to do is we just need to sit down with ETS and make sure that they understand that thousands of students use the escalators every day or would use the escalators every day if they were accessible. But I think one important thing that has to be noted is I think in alleviating the students, we should also allow the students to alleviate themselves. So we need to elevate the students. We should allow them to elevate themselves and often maybe take the stairs. I know whenever I take the train, I always use the stairs. It's healthier, it's better. But for those students who want to use the escalators, I think we just need to talk to ETS. I have a pretty good relationship with them, and that's something that I can bring
seconds.
Up to them the next time I see them. So. Great question.
Thank you. Next up is Horse with a Gun.
To quote Mitch Hedberg, escalators cannot break, they just turn into stairs. I will fix your escalator. I will one-up you. I will turn every staircase into an escalator. I will turn bathrooms into elevators. And I will turn Humanities Building into a launch pad where we can fly to the moon and build a university there. Moon University!
All right, thank you. Which race do you have a question to over on that side?
Yes, I do. My question
which,
is for...
What race?
VP Ops Phi.
All right, no, we'll actually ask a question to the Board of Governors Rep. Do we have any question from Twitter? Yeah.
So for the Board of Governors representative, what exactly did you mean by the resources other executives have that BOG Rep doesn't?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Right, so the Board of Governors representative position is not an executive position. It's not a position within the executive committee. So there are resources that members of the executive committee have access to that the Board of Governors representative position does not. There's staff that work for the SU. It's their job to keep up to speed with policy and advocacy with regards to the university. So executives can access these resources, access the employees of the students' union on a much more regular basis for things like policy briefings and updates on what the university is sort of advocating on and the government as well. So that's the reality, but I see lots of areas where if the Board of Governors representative was given just a little bit more access to these resources, and this ties back into amplify and advocacy, I'd be able to do a much more effective job, and of course Board of Governors representatives in the future would hopefully also be able to do a much more effective job if they had access to these resources. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we will not be taking any more questions after the people who are standing here, just so you know. All right, question on this side.
For the president race?
Do we have anyone for student life on this side at all? Nope. Okay, go ahead.
So executive reports to council is a great way to stay transparent and be accountable towards student council. However, this past year, those reports were repeatedly late. Going forward, what will you do to ensure that these reports are no longer late?
All right, the order for answering will be Horse with a Gun, Petros Kuzmu, and then Sadiq Sumar.
So the reports are never leaked, is that what you said? Sorry, my ears are rubber. All right.
The reports are late.
Excuse me?
Late, not leaked.
What?
Your time's running.
All right. Wonderful. To quote my good friend, Dylan Thomas, they sing their dearest songs. He, she, all of them. Treble and tenor and bass, and the candles mooning each face. Ah, woe, such woe, as the rotten leave reels down in throngs. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Petros Kuzmu.
Thank you for that. That's an excellent question. I think in regards to executives ensuring that their reports are submitted on time, I think that's kind of one of those things where a culture needs to be set where a huge priority is put on Students' Council. And again, not trying to sound like a broken record, but again, trying to find ways we can improve and empower student counselors so that there's a lot more almost respect in terms of saying, we need to make sure that this gets on time. I think that's a really good first step of trying to ensure that for the long run, that reports don't come in late.
Thank you. Next up is Sadiq Sumar.
I think it's partially what Petra said. I think we need to empower students' counselors to make sure that they feel as though they can ask the executives why their reports are late. But it is really one of the president's roles to make sure that they also do hold the executive accountable. I mean, the president is the one person, when talking to Colton about this, the president is the one person who's supposed to know the VP's portfolios and what they're doing the second best after the VP. So the president needs to be able to also make sure that those representatives are held accountable to A, what their goals are and what their platform was, but B, making sure that they communicate that to Students Council and to the greater community, because those reports are available to all students. So if you don't know, su.yulberta.ca, you can find all of our reports under the governance section.
10 seconds.
I know there have been a couple of hiccups this year, but hopefully next year we can turn things around a little bit and make sure that those reports come in on time. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, we'll take a question from this side.
VP Opsfi.
All right, go ahead.
Hey there, Mr. VP Opsfi person running for. So Mr. Le, I looked through your platform, and I mean to ask you this sooner, but I wasn't able to. So you state that you want to strengthen communication channels, and you explain why you want to strengthen them in terms of the great things that we do offer. However, your action items that you want to go about doing this are pretty much repeats of what has been done in the past, primarily the videos that will be stated weekly, reinstating the blog and the Twitter account. In 2011, 2012,
please wrap up your question.
Sorry, there were weekly updates, videos that were being released. So what do you plan to do differently from those times?
Thank you.
It was done, but it wasn't done well. As a marketing student, that's sort of what I live and breathe in. I think if you look on my social media record, you can find that it's more than exceeds the expectations of the average student. If you even look on Twitter, and I've been following along, that's why I haven't been looking up, but I'm just following along, and I tweet actively. You can go to site tweetstats.com, and if you look at every candidate's and every past executive's Twitter history and other social media channels, you can see what they've done. So I think my record is proven. And also, if you Google Josh Lay with any combination of denim, David Suzuki, Steve Aoki, V for Vendetta, I think they'll give you your answer. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, question on this side.
So it's a question for the presidential candidates, and that is, I understand there was much spoken about residences on campus. And my question is, while every residence has is making sure that students are safe and secure, what is happening in Hub? Is there any? What are your thoughts on pushing for more security in Hub? Because it's basic right to security and basic right to a safe space at home.
So. Thank you. The order of answering will be Sadiq, Horse with a Gun, and then Petros.
In terms of Hub security, as far as I know, what has been done and what is being done, I think, in the next couple months, first off, is to make sure that all stairwells have mirrors so that people can see up and down the stairwells to make sure that there aren't any intruders or any strangers trying to break into any apartments or anything like that. Something else that's going on with Hub security is also that they might implement locks so that when students leave their rooms, the door is automatically locked so that intruders can't enter or random strangers can't enter their units. In terms of what we need to do for hub security, I think what we need to do really is take a look at the audit that UAPS hopefully has concluded and see what recommendations come out of that audit. I think it's important to mention that all security measures, we should make sure that students not only feel secure but actually are secure. We shouldn't just put measures in place that we think are the best so that students feel safe. We need to make sure that students actually are safe. It's a multi-million dollar project to work on next year.
All right, next up is Horse with a Gun.
Hallway mirrors are a fantastic idea, my friend, but I say make it a house of mirrors. Make it a veritable labyrinth where your reflection is your own worst enemy. And after that, there will be a series of hidden trap doors that lead to lava pits and great halls 40 miles beneath the top of the earth. We will find our way through and laughing, childlike in our gleeful security. We will be back in the mother's womb, slowly, quietly gestating, growing into productive members of society from the veritable fortress that will be Hub Mall.
Thank you. All right, next up is Petros Kuzmu.
Why do I always have to follow up with the horse? Okay. I think if you look at my presidential platform, I think I'm the only presidential candidate who's actually explicitly mentioned hub security as being a large issue. It's ridiculous. I mean, can any of you guys think of an apartment building or even a shopping mall that's not regularly locked, right? It doesn't exist. Now, the cost of, let's say, having these locks have been, you know, estimated to be $2 million, but the university is willing to invest millions of dollars of having fancy lights on the ceiling of Hub. And I think this is a ridiculous and huge issue that needs to be dealt with. If I elect the president, I'm going to make sure that I work with my vice president of student life to ensure that this is an issue not forgotten, because that's happened all too often. Hub is normally kind of seen as something on the back burner. I think it needs to also be brought up equally as with our advocacy issues on other residences.
10 seconds.
So that's my issue, making sure that Hub doesn't get left out, and that this is an issue that needed to be fixed 40 years ago when Hub was built. So,
thank you. All right, next question. I believe it's for the president as well.
Okay, yeah, my question's also for the presidential race. In the past year in student council, socially responsible and ethical purchasing had a really big sort of was a bit of a hot button issue. And as far as I know, that was fairly dealt with in fairly minimal respect. How would your new administration advance this kind of legislation? And in particular, how would you address animal-based adhesives like paste? Thank you.
All right, the order for answering will be Petros, Sadiq, and then Horse with a Gun.
That's an excellent question. So Councillor McGinn, who's a very passionate social justice advocate, has kind of, me and him had an interesting conversation about this, and he said that the Students' Union's operating policy on ethical purchasing is actually so stringent that it makes it pretty much nearly impossible for us to actually adhere to that. So I think two steps is to actually reanalyze our operating policies, work with Vice President of Operations and Finance, and more importantly, work with other councillors and stakeholders. Look at groups like the social, look at committees like CERC. I feel like that's an extremely important thing to do, work with other social justice advocates and ensure that we have something that's actually, you know, adherable to. So in regards to paste, yeah, man, let's just throw that in the list and let's see if that's an issue we need to be resolving as well. So I'm glad you brought that up.
Thank you. Next up is Sadiq.
I think the best person to answer this question is probably the Vice President of Operations and Finance candidate, Josh Lay. He's been mentioning that a lot during the previous forums. And I think he's probably the best to answer that question because that would fall within his realm as the next VP Operations and Finance, potentially. But I think Petros is right. I think what we need to do is we need to look at the social justice community and figure out a good balance between economic and social sustainability. We need to figure out that balance because we need to make sure that the Students' Union is not only socially just, but also economically viable. So we need to make sure that there's a good balance there. In terms of what counselors can do, just make sure to hold the Vice President of Operations and Finance, potentially Josh Lay, accountable to what he's been saying throughout this entire race, making sure that he does follow through with his promises, making sure that he does adhere to what he has said. I think those are the most important things. We can talk to CERC, we can talk to SUSJ, but most importantly, I think we need to hold Josh Lay accountable when he says these things, so, yeah.
Thank you. Next up is Horse with a Gun.
We will plant gardens. We will start workhouses where we can build what we need. We can make what we need and we can eat what we build. We will take our lips off the withered corporate teat and we will stand together arm in arm as we say, fuck you, Coca-Cola.
Please keep your language clean. Please keep the language clean. You have 40 seconds left.
That's it.
All right. All right, our last question for president.
Hey guys, so my question's also for the presidential candidates. So accountability and communication has been a huge buzzword thrown around in this race. While in-camera voting has been something frequented by council this year, while two of the presidential candidates were sitting on exec. So I was just wondering what your stance on in-camera voting is and if that's something that you plan on reforming during your presidency. Thank you.
Thank you. The order will be a horse with a gun, Petros, then Sadiq.
I say we demolish every building on campus. We turn it into a lovely pasture. We plant flowers. We dance. We cheer and we laugh. I know I sound like a broken record when I say this, but it is no different than the meandering bloviating about platforms and constituencies and initiatives. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Petros.
Thanks a lot for the excellent question, Kate. What is my stance on in-camera voting? A, I feel like there are times where it's needed, and that's just a simple fact. B, I think that it should be used sparingly, and it's something that we can't just simply throw around when we feel like. I think that's really extremely important for us to reanalyze when we should actually use it. Perhaps in my, you know, one of my major platform points of reanalyzing council and seeing if there's ways to improve it, perhaps that could be actually a metric of saying, okay, when is it appropriate for us to actually go in camera and when is it not? And I feel like that's something we can actually consult perhaps with even the Gateway and other stakeholders on campus to find something that's appropriate and something that's fair. So thanks for the question.
Thank you. Next up is Sadiq.
Just to clarify, Kate, were you talking about in-camera sessions or in-camera voting?
Both.
Fair enough. Just to make sure, in terms of in-camera voting, I don't really agree with that. I think our votes need to be public. I think if there's a division in terms of the Students' Council members, I think that needs to be expressed to all students. So in terms of in-camera voting, I don't agree with that. In terms of in-camera session, I think Petros is right. I think there are times in which the Students' Union needs to go in-camera, especially when we're talking about legal issues. But I think we need to take a hard look at that and see what we can reform in terms of in-camera sessions and making those minutes potentially public sometime down the line, developing a process through which Students' Council can make those minutes public. Hopefully that answers both of those questions.
But 10 seconds.
The remaining time I have, check out my website, www.votesadiq.ca. Follow me on Twitter, @VoteSadiq. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, well, that about wraps up the Meyer-Horowitz Forum. Thank you all for coming and joining us today, whether those of you who came here and those of you who are joining us online. Before I let you go, let me remind you that voting is on March 6th and 7th, this Wednesday and Thursday, and that the APERG elections will be done on the same ballot along with the SU election. So after you finish voting for the SU executives, you will be given an opportunity to vote for the APERG board if you have not. Thank you.